Okay. Okay, set. The lens is the gatekeeper of everything. So all of the efforts that every other department, it all has to end up going through the lens for it to mean anything. That's how important it is. Canon asked me to test their new Flex Zoom. It's a T2.4 20-50 focal length zoom. And most importantly, it's full frame. And with this full frame, you're buying yourself about a stop narrower depth of field. So that 2.4 lens suddenly becomes a fast lens. So what we thought we'd do is we'll set up a commercial-esque production. So we found a really great location, sort of modernist house. We got some trained actors. We showed it, you know, quite a range of lighting conditions. It's a non-compromised approach to trying to put this lens through its paces and see how it performs. The main thing about the Flex Zoom is it covers full frame, and there's not many zooms out there that can do that at the moment. And it really performs like a prime lens, actually, if we're honest about this. Like a really high level, like a master prime type. It felt very cinematic. And what I mean by that is it had a kind of a refined quality. And that's what I'm kind of looking for. It's like, can this lens move my emotions rather than how good does it look on a chart? Looking at human faces is a primary human response. So skin tone reproduction is primary. With regard to this Canon Flex lens, I would say it's naturalistic. It wasn't super warm or super cool. Go back to that first shot when we had Amanda sitting on the bench, and it was very light makeup we used. And she was sat there and her skin was glowing, and I knew I had done nothing lighting-wise. And that's when I was like, okay, so this is a refined lens. You know, so the lens has got a lot to do, right? Because the lens has got to have a highly resolving image, but at the same time, it can't look too clinical and the skin looking too unflattering. So it's got to do two jobs at the same time. It's kind of a contradiction in a way, isn't it? It's got to be sharp, but it's got to be sort of smooth. You want to start off with a good amount of resolution in the image. And then once you have that solid beginning, then you can tweak it to your liking. That's good there.
See, that's where the flare's going to go. One point, then she'll break the flare.
We were trying to get a flare, and I kept saying to Josh, can you angle that reflector directly at the lens so we can get a full-on flare? And you can see how, when she crosses the flare, you can see that the contrast difference is very minimal, actually. This wasn't a small light. It was quite a powerful light. We shined directly at the lens, and the flare control was pretty intense. The way a lens falls off in focus is huge. Because so oftentimes when you're talking about bokeh, you're actually talking about how the lens falls off from sharp to soft. Some lenses can be quite abrupt and they have a real bite, which focus pullers love, of course. Other lenses, like more vintage lenses, sometimes that's a softer roll-off, but that can be very pleasing as well. Today, it felt pretty smooth, pretty creamy bokeh. Yeah, I mean, this is a big problem with lens set, is that everything has to match. We did a comparison of the zoom on a wide shot and the prime on a close-up, and they match very well, so no problem there. They seem like they're in the same family. So metadata has become crucial now, because a lot of work we do has got, you know, some kind of post element to it. Traditionally, we'd record it all on bits of paper and they'd get lost and things would get miscommunicated, and that happened all the time and it was very frustrating. So yeah, metadata on a zoom is key. Canon have obviously thought through the focal lengths quite carefully here, because with full frame, I don't personally see a reason to ever need to go wider than 20mm, and certainly 135 I think is a good flat portrait lens that I don't think you need to go any sort of more compressed than that. So yeah, I think those two zooms together covers it.
Let's do that, go back to number ones.
The last sequence was kind of interesting. One of the ideas was to test the breathing of the lens by having quite an extreme focus pull and doing it, you know, quickly to see if is there any image shift in the lens as it's focusing. You know, she comes quite close to the camera. She's probably about 7 foot away from the camera, turns, and we quickly throw the focus back to the building, which is about 20 foot away, 25 foot away, and then back to her. And you'll see there's zero breathing. You're just watching that character, looking back and then looking forward. And it was very immersive.
Okay, set.
That twilight scene when we're zooming, looking at her through the plate glass, that's it. So it had a slightly voyeuristic quality, but in a really dramatic way, the way the zoom was creeping in. Because I don't use physical zooms that much, so when I do see one performing really well, it does intrigue me. And it was interesting because the image was holding so well through that zoom. It felt quite unique, actually. The deeper I get into my craft, the more kind of magical I find glass, you know, and I'm not looking for glass that is just producing a scientifically lab-proven result. I'm looking for glass that has a kind of alchemy to it. And, you know, we're interested in using the best equipment in the world to try and produce the most immersive imagery you can. And this lens feels refined and cinematic enough to be seen as a lens that you can shoot theatrical cinema on. And if it's good enough for theatrical cinema, it's good enough for the work I do.